to welcome you to Theater for Ideas and to thank you all for saving us once more from falling apart financially. I'd also like to say that we will be making a donation to the Women's Liberation since they are having similar problems. The topic for discussion this evening is a dialogue on women's liberation. Jacqueline Ceballos, Germaine Greer, Jill Johnston, Diana Trilling, and Mr. Mailer. Mr. Mailer.
We're going to have a particularly simple format tonight. Each of the ladies is going to talk for about 10 minutes. At the end of that time, if I've been listening carefully, I might be able to have a decent question to ask, which they'll conceivably answer immediately or choose not to. And then perhaps I'll pose a second question to them, which might be brought up later. The evening was billed at one time as Norman Mailer versus, and then the four ladies were listed. I may say that was done almost over my dead body. I may have vanity, but I do not have the vanity to think that one man can take on four women. And on top of that, I suspect that I'll probably find myself in the middle of this dispute. In the recent demise of Harper's Magazine, one of the sad facts that got lost was that The Prisoner of Sex was advertised as that this is the piece that's going to have women's lib picketing the newsstands. Well, that was a disaster. It was one of the reasons why the magazine failed, finally failed in the sense that they failed to be able to keep Willie Morris and his staff. It was because the advertising people had such a different idea of how to go at things, and there was something so barbaric and crude about the whole notion. I mean, anyone who read that piece would be aware that I wasn't interested in trying to pull the tail feathers of woman's lib. I had come to the conclusion that probably was the most important single intellectual event of the last few years, and that, at the least, and that one had to engage it. I think tonight may be an extraordinary night, because I think two enormous intellectual currents have been going on in New York for many years are finally reaching their flood waters. One of them is that peculiar spirit of revolution which inquires further and further and further into the nature of man, woman, and society. And the other is, of course, that blessed spirit of nihilism, which will rip everything apart, including free speech and assembly. I suspect we may have elements of both before the night is out. For now, to save time, let me introduce each of these splendid ladies with the simplest of introductions, since I know one of them very well and one of them hardly at all, and everything in between. So let me introduce first Ms. Jacqueline Ceballos, who is the president of the New York chapter of NOW, the National Organization for Women. Ms. Ceballos.
When Shirley asked me to be on the panel at first, I have to tell you frankly that I refused. She asked me to think about it overnight, and then I thought that it would be cowardly of me not to come here, because, first of all, NOW is supposed to be fighting within the system for changes, and Norman Mailer really represents the establishment. Of course, sort of a liberal part of the establishment, but still, he does represent the establishment. I'm not interested in fighting with Norman Mailer. I really think that in his article in Harper's Magazine, he was sincerely trying to understand. And I guess that's all we can expect of the majority of men. We are too busy doing the work we have to do to fight with the men who disagree with us. And most of us believe that sooner or later they'll come along with us anyway, because they won't have any choice. I represent that large middle class group of women who could have all the comforts and conveniences of life. In fact, I did, but I opted out. Instead, I decided to devote my time to fight for equality of women. I'd like to tell you what we do in the National Organization for Women. This is considered the square organization of women's liberation, but we're not too square that we still don't frighten off many, many women and men because they're afraid of the whole women's liberation movement. I don't think it's necessary to argue about whether women are biologically suited to stay home and wash dishes and take care of men and children all their lives. I don't think that's important. What is important is that the world is changing and that women at last are awakening to the fact that they have a right and a duty to enter into the world and change it and work towards governing the society that governs them. Yes. That's right. All of humanity. My goodness, the excitement has already started. All right, all of humanity. You are absolutely right, but let me speak. For all of humanity. But I'd like to tell you one of the reasons why we don't divert our time fighting for the peace movement or the civil rights movement or changing the environment, because we believe sincerely that the root of everything is women's liberation. We fight on every front. First of all, in employment. In spite of the fact that 40% of the women are working in the United States, we all know, and I know that this is a very sophisticated audience, that women are underpaid and overworked and there is no chance for advancement anywhere. We now teach women how to fight discrimination against their own companies, how to sue their companies. And divorce front, we have been accused, and many women especially are very worried that we are against marriage as an institution. What we are against is the structure of marriage, and even though the structure of marriage is changing in spite of everything, we intend to direct it in what we think is the right direction. If women are to be married in a society that pushes them towards marriage, they should be paid for the work that they do. We believe that every person getting married should receive a booklet stating all their responsibilities in marriage. We believe that every married couple should have marriage insurance in case the marriage breaks up, so the woman will not be subjected to receiving and begging for humiliating alimony. We are working for women or the dependent partner to have social security benefits independent of their husband's or their wife's income. Women should receive pensions. And some of us go so far as to say that women should get paid and they should receive vacations with pay. As far as the image of women is concerned, we're attacking the advertising industry. You know that the woman as portrayed on television all over in the media is a stupid, senile creature. She gets an orgasm when she gets the shiny floor. Before marriage, she's encouraged to keep herself deodorized and as pretty as possible in a doll-like way, in a plastic way, to get the man, because the man is going to be her life. Once she gets him, all the advertising is geared to her cleaning her house and taking care of the children. When she gets a little too old for that, she's the bitter shrew, she's the mother-in-law who's coming to taste that coffee, and she's the poor woman who is losing her husband because she's losing her looks and has to use all sorts of ways to get him back. He's telling me my 10 minutes are up. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ceballos. I'm going to ask you that question that you don't answer now, that you can think about for a while and answer later. In every part of your powerfully concerted and impassioned speech, there were not only forceful political points, which I'll let me finish.
There were not only...
You know, the true perspective of the future is that it will end with nothing but assholes talking to assholes. The question I'd like to ask you, Mr. Biles, is that while everything you presented was certainly to the point and even politically feasible, I would ask you if there's anything in your program that would give us men the notion that life might not continue to be as profoundly boring as it is today. And in sometime in the next 45 minutes, we'll bring it up and talk about it. There was reported to be the most extraordinary jockeying for positions on the order of speech. As it turns out, the way the ladies will speak is in alphabetical order. The next speaker, who I suspect has done a great deal to fill this house, he is that distinguished and young and formidable lady writer, Miss Germaine Greer from England.
In a very different way, possibly, than you expected. I do not represent any organization in this country, and I dare say the most powerful representation I can make is of myself as a writer, for better or worse. I'm also a feminist, and for me the significance of this moment is that I'm having to confront one of the most powerful figures in my own imagination. The being, I think, most privileged in male elitist society, namely the masculine artist, the pinnacle of the masculine elite. Bred as I have been... bred as I have been and educated as I have been, most of my life has been most powerfully influenced by the culture for which he stands. So that I'm caught in a basic conflict between inculcated cultural values and my own deep conception of an injustice. Many professional literati ask me in triumphant tones, as you may have noticed, what happened to Mozart's sister? They ask me that question, it cannot have caused them as much anguish as it has caused me, because I do not know the answer and I must find the answer. But every attempt I make to find that answer leads me to believe that perhaps what we accept as a creative artist in our society is more a killer than a creator, aiming his ego ahead of lesser talents, drawing the focus of all eyes to his achievements, being read now in by millions and paid in millions. One must ask oneself the question in our society, can any painting be worth the total yearly income of 1,000 families? And if we must answer... and if we must answer that it is, and the auction reports tell us so, then I think we are forced to consider the possibility that the art on which we nourish ourselves is sapping our vitality and breaking our hearts. But the problem is very deeply seated, as you can see. I'm agitated in this situation because of the concept I have of the importance of the artist, because of my own instinctive respect for him. Is it possible that the way of the masculine artist in our society is strewn with the husks of people worn out and dried out by his ego? Is it possible that all those that have fallen away, all those competing egos, were insufficiently masculine to stay the course. I turn for some information to Freud, treating Freud's description of the artist as an ad hoc description of the artist's psyche in our society, and not as in any way a metaphysical or eternal pronouncement about what art might mean. And what Freud said, of course, has irritated many artists who've had the misfortune to see it. He longs to attain to honor, power, riches, fame, and the love of women, but he lacks the means of achieving these gratifications. As an eccentric little girl who thought it might be worthwhile, after all, to be a poet, coming across these words for the first time was a severe check. The blandness of Freud's assumption that the artist was a man sent me back into myself to consider whether or not the proposition was reversible. Could a female artist be driven by the desire for riches, fame, and the love of men? And all too soon it was very clear that the female artist's own achievements will disqualify her for the love of man. That no woman yet has been loved for her poetry. And we love men for their achievements all the time. What can this be? Can this be a natural order that wastes so much power, that frets a little girl's heart to pieces? I had no answers, except that I knew the argument was irreversible. And so I turned later to the function of women vis-a-vis art as we know it, and I found that it fell into two parts, that we were either low, sloppy creatures, or menials, or we were goddesses, or worst of all, we were meant to be both, which meant that we broke our hearts trying to keep our aprons clean. Sylvia Plath's greatest poetry was sometimes conceived while she was baking bread. She was such a perfectionist. And ultimately, such a fool. The trouble is, of course, that the role of the goddess, the role of the glory and the grandeur of the female in the universe, exists in the fantasy of the male artist. And no woman can ever draw it to her heart for comfort. But the role of menial, unfortunately, is real. And that she knows because she tastes it every day. So the barbaric yawp of utter adoration for the power and the glory and the grandeur of the female in the universe is uttered at the expense of the particular living woman every time. And because we can be neither one nor the other with any peace of mind, because we are unfortunately improper goddesses and unwilling menials, there is a battle waged between us. And after all, in the description of this battle, maybe I find a justification of my idea that the achievement of the male artistic ego is at my expense. For I find that the battle is dearer to him than the peace would ever be. The eternal battle with women, he boasts, sharpens our resistance, develops our strength, enlarges the scope of our cultural achievements. So is the scope, after all, worth it? Again, the same question, just as if we were talking of the income of 1,000 families for a whole year. You see, I strongly suspect that when this revolution takes place, art will no longer be distinguished by its rarity, or its expense, or its inaccessibility, or the extraordinary way in which it is marketed. It will be the prerogative of all of us, and we will do it as those artists did whom Freud understood not at all, the artists who made the Cathedral of Chartres or the mosaics of Byzantium, the artists who had no ego and no name.
The sentiments were exquisite, but the means you offered, and in fact the means that women's liberation offers, to go from here to that point where we'll be artists all, belongs to a species of social instrumentality that I call diaper Marxism. For instance, the question which I now present to you that I'd like you to think about and we'll talk about later is there anything necessarily so finally debilitating to the human notion that a woman be both a goddess and a slob at separate hours of her existence? The element in women's liberation, both liberal as personified by now and radical women's liberation as personified by the electronic forces just without, both subscribe to a unilinear notion of human nature. There's absolutely nothing of the dialectic within it. In other words, there seems no notion at all implicit in anything I've heard in women's liberation that it may be precisely through leading double existences and through going through certain extremes of experience that one begins to achieve a higher state. Now, I know you're dying to answer immediately, but you've got to hold it and think about it. The next speaker is that master of free associational prose in the Village Voice. Miss Jill Johnston.
Master of free associational prose.
I think Germaine was born in Australia and I was born in England. Were you born in Australia? I was born in England. I can't help it. That's just the first thing I thought of. But the title of this episode is New Approach. All women are lesbians, except those who don't know it naturally. They are, but don't know it yet. I am a woman and therefore a lesbian. I am a woman who is a lesbian because I am a woman, and a woman who loves herself naturally, who is other women, is a lesbian. A woman who loves women loves herself naturally. This is the case. A woman is herself, is all woman, is a natural born lesbian. So we don't mind using the name like any name. It is quite meaningless. It means naturally. I am a woman, and whatever I am, we are. We affirm being what we are, the way, of course, all men are homosexuals. Being, having a more sense of their homo, their homo-ness, their ecce homo-ness, their ecce prince and lord and masterness. The 350 years of Abraham, intersample. Abraham lived 350 years because the Bible ages are only a succession of sons and fathers and grandfathers intensely identifying with their ancestors. Their son so identified naturally with the father that he believed he was the father, and of course he was, as was Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Esau, and Reuben, and Simeon, and Levi, and Judah, and Joseph. Each one lived 350 years. But who are the daughters of Rachel and Ruth and Sarah and Rebecca, the rest? We do not know the daughters, never had any daughters. They had only sons who begat more sons and sons. So we have very little sense from that particular book of the lineage and ligaments and legacies and identities of mothers and daughters and their daughters and their mothers and daughters and sisters, who were naturally not lesbians if they had nothing of each other save sons. So now we must say, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a woman be born again, she cannot see the kingdom of goddess. A woman must be born again to be herself, her own eminence and grace, the queen, queen self, whose mother has pressed upon her mouth innumerable passionate kisses, so sighs. There is in every perfect love a law to be accomplished too, that the lover should resemble the beloved and be the same, and the greater is the likeness, brighter will the rapture flame. Ah, lover and perfect equal, I meant that you should discover me so by my faint interaction, and I, when I meet you, mean to discover you by the like in you. I want she who is a tomboy in me. I want she who is very female in me. I want she who is British about me. I want she who is ugly American about me. I want she who is the cunt and the balls and the breasts of me and the long, straight, browny hair and the gangly boarding school adolescent in a navy blue blazer. Narcissism qui consiste à se choisir soi-même comme objet érotique. Excuse my French. And I want the men to carry my boxes of books for me and carry me up the daily piggyback and pay for me everywhere and adore me as a lesbiated woman. Over the inevitable, we shall not grieve. This is the body that Jill built. Ecce Lita the lesbian, ecce Greta the gay Gertrude, the gay, gay, gayness of being gay, of being. To be equal, we have to become who we really are, and women, we will never be equal women until we love one another, women. Special from the White House. The President of the United States announced last night the appointment of a lesbian to his cabinet. It's nice if you can invite them in. They usually come in without knocking. Yep. Liberal schmibberal. Maybe. We should invite one of them to dinner. One of what, dear? She is a bit odd, isn't she? I mean, you know how we'd feel if a black man was interested in our daughter. Ah! Oh, God, and she might make a pass at my wife. What do you say to the naked lady? Please, sorry, thank you. We're getting to the bottom of women's lib. We're going down on women's lib. I'm beside myself with love for you when you're beside me, my love. The beginning of the universe is right now, if all tinks are at this momentum being cremated. And the end of the universe is right now, if way we went to see the dairy of a skinzo pretty girl. Oh, why didn't her mother straighten out her teeth when she was young? Oh, she is involved in many strange and wondrous adventures. Oh, in short, she had come into that abnormal condition known as elation. Oh, she did not yet love, and she loved to love. She sought what she might love, and love with loving. Oh, what can she say now that is not the story of so many others? Oh, do not fail me, she says. You are my last chance, indeed our last chance to save the West. And who wants the moon when we can land on Venus? Thus, too, is the heterosexual institution over, spiritually over, and the new thing now that is happening is the withdrawal of women to give each other their own sense of self, a new sense of self, until women see in each other the possibility of a primal commitment, which includes sexual love. They will be denying themselves the love and value they readily accord to men, thus affirming their second-class status. Until all women are lesbians, there will be no true political revolution. I suppose I should be leaning on my sword, describing my defeat. Some women want to have their cock and eat it too. And lesbian is a label invented by anybody to throw it at any woman who dares to be a man's equal. And lesbian is a good name. It means nothing, of course, or everything. So we don't mind using the name. In fact, we like it, for we can be proud to claim allusion to the island made famous by Sappho. The birds are talking to us in Greek again. And isn't it wonderful what a lot of devotion there is to us lying around the universe? Especially to those all involved in some penis she's grabbing her cunt around. Oh, well, Lillian over and out. He said, I want your body, and she said, you can have it when I'm through with it. From the White House. Last night, the President of the United States, clad only in a skin.
Now, mail it. It's not fair to the other speakers. Jill's had 15 minutes already, and you all want a chance to ask questions. We want to have a little debate between us. Hey, you know, it's great that you pay 25 bucks to see three dirty overalls on the floor when you can see lots of cock and cunt for $4 just down the street.
Is there a possibility I can skip my question and finish my...
Jill, you did it already. Now, come on, either play with the team or pick up your marbles and get lost. Come on. There's a lot we want to talk about tonight, and I want to talk to you about lesbianism, goddammit. You know, I'm interested in what you said. Now, you can play these games, but they're silly. The people who argue that their favorite speaker should finish are the kind of people who like to play checkers on moldy boards. Come on, Jill, be a lady.
What's the matter, Mel? Are you threatened because you found a woman you can't...
Hey, Cunty, I've been threatened all my life, so take it easy. What do you want to do, Joe? You want to skip to your last sentence?
Rita, what can they do? Rita, what can he do?
Now, wait a minute. Wait.
All right, I'll tell you what we'll do.
Wait a minute.
All right, we'll take a vote. We'll take a vote. But I'm going to do the counting. If you don't think that I've got enough fairness to do the count properly, then come and get this mic away from me. Those who wish Jill to continue, say aye. Those who wish Jill not to continue, say no. From the bottomless pits of my honesty, I think you lost a squeaker, Jill. The next speaker is Diana Trilling, whom I will introduce from the rostrum. Hey, if you want to go over there, whatever, Diana's going to talk, you know. The next speaker, whose soul will doubtless improve from the fortitude of having to hold your attention for the next 10 minutes, is that lady of much soul and much establishment who has been one of our leading, if not our leading, literary lady critic for many, many, many years, Miss Diana Trilling.
I was first asked to join the discussion this evening. I, of course, already knew that women's liberation represented no single movement, no single point of view about the condition of women, but that it probably had as many definitions as there were women attracted to the idea of changing their lives, or men aware of the mounting tides of female unrest in our society. I knew that there were people for whom it meant a new strategy of personal assertion, people for whom it meant a new occasion for cultural assault, people for whom it meant a long-delayed revivification of the women's rights movement, people for whom it was a prophetic vision of an erotic utopianism, people for whom it was Thurber's war between men and women. What I did not know, and only learned as I watched one woman speaker after another drop away from this panel as if under penalty of some special form of female torture should she submit to the presence of a male moderator, and in particular this male moderator, was that women's liberation was an authoritarianism already this advanced in purpose and efficiency. Here we have accomplished virtually nothing on behalf of women other than perhaps to open a door on grievances which they have either tried to suppress or lived with in loneliness. And are we already so sure we can name the enemy and get him into our gun sight? Well, I am not at all sure that I can so easily name the enemy of my sex. But much as I dissent from some of the attitudes which inform Norman Mailer's celebrated article in Harper's Magazine, I am fairly certain it is not Mailer. I hope he will forgive me for saying this, but big as he looms on the literary scene, and I long ago put myself on record as considering him the most important writer of our time, he is not that big. He is not as big as biology, for instance, or culture. Certainly, he is not as big as the combined forces of biology and culture. Although, as I recall, Mailer makes little or no explicit mention of biology in his Harper's piece, the concept of biology, of course, permeates the prisoner of sex. Indeed, it provides the chief determinant of Mailer's view of the relation of men and women. This cannot come as an entire shock to anyone acquainted with his previous work. It was possible to have adumbrated a good deal of Mailer's present position from, say, his old and persisting rejection of birth control. Still, I don't think we could have been prepared for quite this much of a deterministic emphasis in a writer who, in so many areas other than that of the relation of the sexes, has always been so preeminent a spokesman for the unconditioned life, an unconditioned culture, and even an unconditioned politics. Rigorously as I would oppose myself to such dangerous poetic excesses of Mailer's as his stand against contraception, I am wholly disinclined to join the current female attack upon him. For the simple fact is that I would gladly take even Mailer's poeticized biology in preference to the no biology at all of my spirited sisters. I think there is not only more life in it, I think there is not only more life in it, but better life. But, and this is a big but, I am also not inclined to join in any attack upon even the extreme female liberationists, much as I might reject their views, if this attack has its source in the wish to protect the sexual culture in which we now live. Mailer accepts our sexual culture pretty much as given, or at least that part of it which has to do with the relative status of the sexes. I do not. Where I separate from most of the radical liberationist views which are winning the facile assent of women troubled by their present situation is that they seek a culture which will invalidate the biological differences between the sexes. Where I separate from Mailer is that while honoring biology, he implicitly acquiesces in the intolerable uses which culture has made of the biological differences between the sexes. In something of the same speculative spirit, Eric Erickson talks about the existence in women of something he calls inner space, which he says defines their sense of themselves and their possibilities. It is not my impression that either of these gifted clinicians is undertaking to put limits on the capacities of women to employ and enjoy their fullest possible range of activity outside the home. But Freud, unhappily, is undertaking exactly this, and so I think is Mailer, though he doesn't come out with it as bluntly as the middle-class doctor in Vienna. I defer to none in my high regard for Freud. I will nevertheless take from him, as from Mailer, only that which affirms and adds to life, discarding from his work as from the work of anyone, including Mailer. I just want to finish. I referred to none in my high regard for Freud. I will nevertheless take from him, or Mailer, only that which affirms and adds to life, discarding from his work as from the work of anyone, including the female liberationist, whatever is impoverishing and absolute. And among those efforts of the women's liberationists which I find most impoverishing and most absolutist are the doctrines now being promulgated on the female orgasm. Surely it is remarkable that the same people who properly criticize our society for its harsh and unimaginative treatment of homosexuals have no hesitation in dictating to women where they are to find their single path to sexual enjoyment. I am talking, of course, about the campaign now being mounted to persuade women that there is no such thing as a vaginal orgasm. Therefore, they might as well dispense with men even in bed. Nothing in the sexual culture of recent decades has been more justifiably attacked than the idea of a single definition of what is or is not normal in sexual desire or response. As an added benefit of our deliverance from a tyrannical authority in our choice of sexual partners or in our methods of pursuing sexual pleasure, I could hope we would also be free to have such orgasms as in our individual complexity we happen to be capable of. Biology is all very well, Norman. All these women have biology, but they also have a repressive and life-diminishing culture to contend with. Your piece in Harper's has your always beautiful intention of life enhancement, and it is full of a certain kind of splendid imagination about women. I suppose we could call it the imagination of women in love. But it fails in its imagination of the full humanity of women, as it would never fail in its imagination of the full humanity of men.
Now, that concludes the first phase of the evening, the formal phase, if you will, or the most formal phase. I really would like to present a question to Jill Johnson, wherever you are, Jill. And I will also try to give Ms. Ceballos and Ms. Greer a few more minutes, because they were the kindest of the two ladies in keeping into the 10 minutes that I asked for, to which they went over less than the others, flopped over less than the others. All right, now, I was not surprised to find that my dear old friend Diana Trilling had, as usual, misread just about everything I'd said. Because you can only be dear friends with literary critics who never do read you straight, but read you with their full and specific sympathy. What I was trying to say in my usual incoherent fashion in The Prisoner of Sex was that biology is not, or physiology, if you will, is not destiny, but it is half of it. And that if you try to ignore that fact, you then get, at least so far as I can see any perspectives of the future, you then get into it the most awful totalitarianism of them all, because it's a left totalitarianism. I think there's something in the human spirit that can somehow bear the notion of a fascist or right-wing totalitarianism, because it offers us at least the romantic dream that we can all form into some sort of underground cadres and have an adventurous life at the end where all of us men and women are equal and comrades. But if we get a left-wing totalitarianism, that means the end of all of us, because we will have nothing but scrambled minds trying to overcome the incredible shock that the destruction of human liberty came from the left and not the right. And there is an element in woman's liberation that terrifies me. It terrifies me because it's humorless, because with the exception, let's say, of Germaine Greer's book on the female eunuch, there's been almost no recognition that the life of a man is also difficult, and that all the horrors that women go through, some of them absolutely determined by men, even more of them, I suspect, determined by themselves, because we must face the simple fact that it may be there's a profound reservoir of cowardice in women which had them welcome this miserable, slavish life. But in any case, whether it's their fault or men's fault, what has to be recognized is there's nothing automatic about female liberty. Every female liberty is going to be achieved the way every liberty is achieved, which is going to be achieved against the grain, against the paradox of the fact that there's much in human life which forbids liberty. So I'm not here to say that every woman must have a child, or every woman must have a vaginal orgasm, or that every woman must conceive in any way that I lay down. Anyone who says that about me just doesn't know how to read my sentences. What I'm trying to say is, let's really get hip about this little matter and recognize that the whole question of woman's liberation is the deepest question that faces us, and we're going to go right into the very elements of existence and eternity before we're through with it. Because the whole question of how much liberty men and women can find with each other, and how much sharing of those dishes that they can do goes into the center of everything. And I'd like the discussion to go at that level. I'm perfectly willing. If you wish me to act the clown, I will take out my modest little Jewish dick and put it on the table. You can all spit at it and laugh at it, and then I'll walk away and you'll find it was just a dildo I left there. I hadn't shown you the real one. But if we're going to have a decent discussion, we all got here tonight at great various efforts to ourselves, let's have it on the highest level we can. I would ask Jill Johnson something, which is that she put very neatly half of the notion, I think, of women's liberation right up front, which is women's liberation is two things. It is a profoundly political movement, and it's a profoundly sexual movement, which quite naturally takes on huge lesbian overtones. That does not mean at all that every woman who's interested in women's liberation is a lesbian. Obviously not. Anyone who would go ahead and say, I then said that, is a fool. But what I am saying is it's quite natural for lesbians to center on women's liberation because there's a peculiar difficulty to lesbianism, which homosexuals, although they are much cursed, would, I suspect, not have, which is every man is vulnerable to homosexuality because he cannot have it with a woman. He must go to a man to fundamentally feel like a woman to it. He must go to a man to have something up his anus or in his mouth. Not up mine, buddy. With women, the difficulty is that any man who's really a superb lover can be about 90% as good to a woman as a lesbian, just doing the things that a lesbian does, and then he's got all the other stuff. So the result is that lesbians do have a tough time, and I think it accounts in part for that intense detestation they have of men. And it's around that intense detestation of men that the worst aspects of women's liberation are forming. So the question I would ask Jill Johnson is, what is she going to do about all us 90%ers? All right. Thank you. And the ladies can talk at any turn they wish. I think my formal attempts to hold this evening in restraint will now be kept down to dealing occasionally with a brilliant contender from the outer human spaces. Okay, the evening is all of ours now, but I still will try to wield some limp sort of gavel. Thank you.
Who'd like to talk first?
You made this very quick, as I said, this very quick dismissal of the biological cell. But after that, 8 times you referred to something that you described as the Oedipal family or the Oedipal situation. And as I understood it in the context, each time you meant the family that rejects the child is an Oedipal family. Now, if that is the way you're going to read Freud, you will have to dismiss him as a fool because he never said things like that. But it's there, isn't it?
In marriage, one repeats the Oedipal situation.
No, I have the actual places marked.
By all means, quote them, but that's my impression of what I meant.
Yes.
I adopt the same attitude to Freud as you do. I quote him where it suits me, and I don't where it doesn't.
Yes, right. I didn't say that I quote him where it suits me. I said I take from him that which suits me. I don't misquote him.
One of the characteristics of oppressed people is that they always fight among themselves.
What?
One of the characteristics of oppressed people is they always fight among themselves.
I don't feel as oppressed as you do, and I'm not fighting with you. I really can't. You see, the thing is that I can't let all women be spokesmen for me because I'm not for their programs necessarily. I have a great deal of loyalty to my sex and a great deal, as a matter of fact, and I've had it for a very long time. But that doesn't mean that I can be indiscriminate about the positions that I subscribe to just because they're put forward by other women. That would seem to be an abdication of intelligence.
But that is understood.
Is it? All right.
Absolutely.
Okay, then you must have accused me of quarreling with someone within the minority.
It's just that we're having a great deal of difficulty understanding each other, and the use of the word misquote could hardly be construed as magnanimous under the circumstances.
Yeah, that's true.
Mark, I just would like to say that the emphasis in this is that the whole torturesome problem for women of how much of their destiny is biological or physiological can begin to be answered by this means. In other words, I'm not going to sit here and say that I know what woman's destiny is and it is biological. Of course, that's absurd. How can I know? We can all have our guesses. But the notion is that if you have a number of societies all working on fundamentally different principles, there's no reason at all why in a technological age that human liberty at least cannot be finally arrived at. And it would be possible at the end of 50 or 100 years we'll begin to discover extraordinary things about the nature of human relations in different kinds of societies and the ways in which they can work. And whether they'll be able to live peacefully side by side or not is, of course, best left for liberal claptrap. It doesn't matter. They'll probably not live that well side by side, but we certainly don't live that well side by side now. The important thing is we'll find out whether children really can raise themselves. If there are going to be any number of victims of this all over the place, there'll also be people, when people want to have a child and live together and raise children by themselves, they'll be able to do it with an extraordinary sense of freedom and not that heaviness they feel today where they wonder if something is wrong with them. Even Greer, who's written this absolutely lovely book, fails manfully, let me say, I kept getting lost in her argument because she didn't really know quite where it all happened. But, for instance, when you were talking about the English clergy in the 17th century and stuff, I really couldn't, maybe my mind wandered, but I didn't feel you got to the point.
16.
Well, then obviously my mind wandered. You see, I really have a thumb in mind. I can't remember numbers.
Every population study reveals that something happened to the structure of the family between feudalism and the Renaissance, but I couldn't really give you the exact day upon which everybody stopped living in stem families.
No, but I think you can agree that it isn't but a simple matter of the men tyrannizing the women. I mean, if it's just that the we men have been tyrannizing you women for all these years, then we really do have an enormous dialogue to continue because, and the work hasn't been done. I mean, my God, if Kate Millett's the one who's done the work, then we're all doomed.
What did you say?
If Kate Millett is the one who has done the historical work which establishes that men control women in a political class system, then we are all doomed.
I would be more surprised than Kate to hear that she has been charged with having done this. Every single feminist knows that the analysis that we have to make of society is very intricate and will take a long time. If it took Mao Zedong so long to actually define the particular causes and problems involved in what was a blank slate situation, we have the most overwritten slate, the most over-indoctrinated and cowed population to try to turn on, and we have so many intricate problems involved in each level of our society, but it's quite absurd to demand of any woman at this stage that she show you the complete analysis or that she stand convicted of having made it.
I'm all for that. I'm all for that. But I would ask you, why then do you women keep saying, without having made the analysis, why do you keep being so certain that it's entirely the male fault?
I didn't know that any women were certain that it was entirely the male fault. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, that's precisely what we're trying to elicit. And if the fact is that men have been unconsciously tyrannical, and I think it probably is the case, then it's certain also that they were debauched by their own tyranny and degraded by it and confused by it almost as much as the people they tyrannized over.
But we're in agreement on this. This is just old socialism when you get down to it.
He is not.
I'm trying to get a dialogue going, and I'll be perfectly willing to disappear into the woodwork when the dialogue flows. All right, at this point, I think what we'd like to do, there's an old tradition in the theater of ideas, which is that there are any number of people who've been invited specifically because of their particular knowledge or general knowledge on a subject, and they're generally seated in the first few rows because they've been invited to come. A monstrously unfair procedure, we all know. And they are given the privilege, because the theater of ideas is an institution founded on privilege. It is an enclave that you are visiting here, young nihilists, and you will have to learn in this society of the future where we have many worlds that when you visit the other turf, you got to conform to the other turf and you can have their fun if they ever dare to visit your turf. Now, the first questions then will be addressed to any of the panelists except myself because I haven't indeed been talking much too much.
Betty Friedan.
Be accurate, Betty.
Norman, I will define accuracy for myself. I don't need you. no,
it'll still
I
give me the leisure to have opinions.
I was wondering if it might possibly, even tonight, indicate that the world might be much less boring when instead of the monolithic, changeless, eternal face of Eve, who never transcends her biological self, we finally reach the beginning point of self-definition, which you are reacting to somewhat like your predecessors 100 years ago, who said the dog talks, you know, that a woman should be here talking at all is something you are finding a little hard to take, but that we talk in different tones. We don't all agree. We have the right to define our own differences and quarrel over our own accuracies and find our own ideologies, and even you might find that less boring in the end.
I simply don't know what you're talking about. Betty, you are just making speeches. You are appealing to the lowest element in this audience. And you've been a mucker. I've been on platforms with women all my life. My God, you act as if suddenly women are in public speaking. They've been doing that for 100 years. We're not talking about that. What we're talking about is the extraordinary possibilities that exist in woman's liberation. You're still talking about it as if I'm completely opposed to it, which I never was. Well, you ladies are very patronizing too. We're all stuck-up snots. How's that? Maybe. We'll all find out, maybe.
Susan Sontag.
I want to ask a very quiet question to Norman and to Diana also, though it obviously applies to the others. Norman, it is true that women find, with the best of will, the way you talk to them patronizing, and one of the things is your use of the word lady. When you, and this is what I want to ask Diana, when you said, Diana Trilling, foremost lady literary critic, if I were Diana, I wouldn't like to be introduced that way, and I would like to know how Diana feels about it. I don't like being called a lady writer, Norman. I know it seems like gallantry to you, but it doesn't feel right to us. It's a little better to be called a woman writer. I don't know why, but you know words count. We're all writers, we know that. Well, how about a woman doctor, a woman lawyer? Yeah, I mean, if you were introducing James Baldwin, you wouldn't say our foremost Negro writer. And we certainly wouldn't say a man writer and so on. A lot of it.
Susan,
no, I really
Susan,
ask you this,
Susan,
not in an argumentative
Paris is worth a mass. I will never use the word lady again in public.
No, I want to ask you, Susan.
Susan, you put the question to me, too. I don't like it, and I recognize the point you're making very well. But sometimes I think that it's like saying lady runner or lady high jumper or something of that kind. Within the culture, it has that peculiarity, doesn't it? And so I permit it on that basis. I don't really like it.
I think you ought to object to it.
Cynthia,
at least he didn't say a housewife who writes.
I would like to answer Susan, if I may. I could have called Diana a woman critic or a female critic. I could not call her
a critic.
I could have called her a critic, but I wish to say that she was. I wish to say that she was the best in kind. Now, may I answer the question? No, I didn't. The fact of the matter is that literary criticism has not been an activity that women have engaged in for nearly as long as men. And there are good reasons. There are good reasons why there are very few good lady critics around. And anyway, as you all should have known, if you had had the wit, I was doing it precisely to put Diana on. You're all singularly without wit.
Lucy Commissar,
I'd like to ask Germaine Greer whether she thinks that there's a relationship between the way sexuality and the relationship between men and women has evolved, namely that masculinity is based on dominance over women, power over women, ultimately violence over women, and the fact that our civilization has been one in which men have always striven to have power over other men, and this has led again to violence. As a matter of fact, a lot of the words that we talk about to describe sexuality are the same words we talk about to describe war. In fact, in Norman's book, The Naked and the Dead, I recall a passage where he goes back and forth from one metaphor to the other in describing a shell that is blowing something up, and sometimes he talks about it in sexual terms, and sometimes he talks about, when he's talking about sex, he talks about it in terms of war. At one part he talked about his penis as the Avenger, and I wonder whether part of the problem that we will solve when we do away with the notion of male dominance over women and male power over women, and the question of wife beating, incidentally, is not a joke. It's very serious. You know, during the Middle Ages, the church regulated this. This was something they did out of goodness. They said that men could beat their wives with whips and cudgels, but not with iron bars. It's kind of funny, but it's a sick joke. It's a very sick joke, and this kind of violence, which has gone on for centuries, which men have used against women and which they have also used against each other. One of the things which I found very interesting when I finally got around to reading Lionel Tiger's book, when it got into paperback, was that he was not only saying that men were superior to women, he said that there are some men who are superior to other men and to women, and they should rule, and to me, that's fascist.
I look forward very much to the advance of women's liberation, because the women are finally going to have to come into contact with the best aspect of the male brain, which is its modest accuracy. Dear Lucy Commissar, I did not make those remarks. I had characters who made them. I had a general who was a profoundly latent homosexual in his own right, Not my latent homosexuality, his latent homosexuality. And he had these wonderful images about the shell as a phallus, and I had a great deal of fun at the time I was writing it. I was thinking, oh, that shows how homosexual those generals are. So I wasn't saying that for me. The same thing that I was writing about Sergius O'Shaughnessy. He was a man as tall as Germaine Greer. He was a god, and he spoke of
his penis, the Retaliator, while referring humorously to Septimus O'Shaughnessy, who resembles you in many ways.
The Retaliator is not quite so formidable as the Avenger.
I'm afraid I'll have to take a woman's view of that.
You are free to take my view, but in fact, I overtook your question. If you still remember it, would you answer?
I do remember it. I think the whole problem is that we all realize, one way or another, that we've been ruled by force, and the world has been ruled by force as long as anyone can remember, and that if we are on the brink of a revolution, and it's that or death, then it must be that the only revolution which will exchange the rule of force for something else, for a more intricate and sophisticated social order built on some much more complicated interaction of faculties and people. Our enemy seems to be as impersonal as General Motors.
Should we go to the audience?
Cynthia Ozick. The reason Mr. Mailer appears not to comprehend and appears to patronize, I think I'm on to it. I'll let you into it also. He's not He's not not comprehending, and he's not patronizing. He's a priest. And I'm not indulging in mockery or clowning, which you warned us against, Mr. Mailer. It's just that having read The Prisoner of Sex, it suddenly, and I read it, I finished it on the subway coming. The thing that's going on in there is a return to the primal, erotic, basic religion of the world that we know in the Indian lingam, which grows a stone phallus growing out of dusty white waysides in India and ringed round with laurel wreaths. We see, the women here, and particularly Miss Sontag, have been talking in terms of justice, which is the basis of civilization. But a priest does not, a sacerdotal, sexual, transcendentalist priest like Mr. Mailer cannot be concerned with justice rooted in civilization, because he has left Jacob's tent to become Esau. And this was a statement. I do have a question. This question, I have been fantasizing it for many, many years, since advertisements for myself. Only I always thought it would take place at the Y, and now it's here, and it's a... this is the truth. This is a fantasy. This is my moment to live out a fantasy. Mr. Mailer, in advertisements for myself, you said, quote, "A good novelist can do without everything but the remnant of his balls." For years and years, I've been wondering, Mr. Mailer, when you dip your balls in ink, what color ink is it?
Ozick, if I don't find an answer in a hurry, I think we're going to have to agree the color is yellow. I will cede the round to you. I don't pretend that I've never written an idiotic or stupid sentence in my life, and that's one of them.
A hand? Peter Fisher of Columbia University.
I'm addressing this to the women. I think we've heard enough from the chairman there. Mr. Mailer, both here and in his Harper's article, referred to homosexuals or described them as female men. And I think his negative attitude towards homosexuals reflects a perhaps subconscious or deeper level negative valuation of women. I'd like to hear whether the women feel there's a connection between the women's liberation movement and the gay liberation movement.
Actually, I've always thought that it was part and parcel of the same movement. I know this means that some of my sisters part company with me on this issue. I think the simplest way for me to describe my attitude to the whole question is that it seems that sexual politics, by and large, has something to do with the act of fucking being to the advantage of the one who fucks and to the disadvantage of the one who is fucked. And as far as I can see, and the one who is fucked, be it male or female or a goat or a pig or a stone, is always characterized as female and inferior. And we all have an interest in changing the grammar of that verb, of opening it out to all its many, many possible permutations, and getting our eyes off the retaliator for 5 minutes.
Can would you mind giving your name?
Ruth Mandel. And I have an insecurity to add to the insecurities here. I'm asking, as a woman, I think, who does not feel right now the need for children, who does not feel right now that she wants to merge with a man or a woman or anybody but just to find myself, if biologically I don't find myself tied down to my body so that it limits the definitions of me, doesn't that kind of, I'm asking, maybe Mr. Mailer can answer me. Is he tied down so much to his body that he can't define himself outside of it?
What about your word?
I'm going to try to answer your question, but I'm going to answer it in my own terms, if you don't mind. I'm going to try to turn it around a little, and perhaps I'll answer you, perhaps I won't. What I was trying to say in The Prisoner of Sex over and over again is that there's nothing in woman's liberation, or in that matter, in most left thought that men have come up with, that deals with what I think is the heart of the problem. Now, this is what I think the heart of the problem is. If you hate the fact that I think this is the heart of the problem, fine. But I do think the heart of the problem is that human nature strives in the way it works against painful, torturing paradoxes. And that I'm quite aware that many women, perhaps most of the women on Earth by now, don't want to have children, don't want to be in that sexual, organic, biological game. And maybe they're right. I don't know, and I'm not saying stop them. I'm not saying they're evil. I'm not saying they're wrong. I'm saying we're going to have to find out that human history has gotten to the point where the majority of women are essentially rebelling. But we can save a lot of time if we cut out the crap and the name-calling. Because the one thing that really is going to close off the ranks of men against the power of this movement is precisely the fact that men have had to deal with the abysmal lack of a sense of justice that women have from their point of view. Now, you may counter by saying, yes, that's because that's a male sense of justice. All right, and maybe it is. But in the dialogue, you've got to allow us our terms as well. If you're going to quote something that we say, you've got to learn to say that we didn't say it in our own voice, we said it in the voice of one of our characters. Which means next that we may or may not have meant it ourselves, we may have meant the opposite of it. Don't you know the simple functions of the novel? In the novel, you have characters who tend to represent your point of view, and characters who represent the opposite of your point of view, and characters who represent some passing facet of your point of view. And if you ladies are not going to go in for that, but are just going to go in for a lot of baseball abuse, then let me point out to you where the paradox of male and female violence takes place. When a man and a woman have a bitter, furious, violent quarrel, there comes a point, if the man is stronger, as he usually is, not always, but usually, when he is either going to hit that woman or not. Now, if he hits the woman, he's lost the argument because finally he has blown up the premise of the argument. On the other hand, if a man swears to himself that he will never strike a woman, and he's dealing with a woman who has less honor than he does, which, believe me, ladies, is conceivable, then that woman will proceed that you're asking for a dialogue. Here it is. This is my half of dialogue. You can counter. I'll teach you and you teach me. Fuck you. I want to teach you too. I mean, fuck you, you know. You know, I'm not going to sit here and listen to you harridans harangue me and say, yes'm, yes'm. Let me aim the point. When a man's engaged with a woman, when a man has sworn he will not strike a woman, and the woman knows that, and uses that, and uses it, and uses it, then she comes to a point where she's literally killing that man because the amount of violence that's being aroused in him is flooding his system and slowly killing him. So she's engaged at that point in an act of violence and murder, even though no blows are exchanged. Now, all I'm getting at is this is the simple existential difficulty of the moment. The argument about the justice in this human relation is where is that point? Because that's where there's absolutely never any agreement, whether it's the man or the woman who is playing with the point. But if you women are not willing to recognize that life is profoundly complex and that women as well as men bugger the living juices out of it, then we have nothing to talk about. Again.
All women come to resemble their mothers, said a character in one of Oscar Wilde's plays. That is their tragedy. No men come to resemble theirs. That is their tragedy. I'm interested in how the transformations that you envisage might result in a transformation of that theatrical down curve.
It's a very good question.
I can only say in answer to that question that I do not resemble my mother at all. Physically, if that's what you meant, and not in any other respect as far as I can make out. It seems to me to be based on a false premise. And in positing the question in that way, you begged it.
I think it's a marvelous question. It's the question that Miss Greer was offended because I don't agree with many things in her book. I didn't mean to be rude about this disagreement. I hope I wasn't. But one of the questions that went through my mind all through the book was precisely the question that John Hollander just asked. If women are not to grow by identification with their mothers, what are they to grow by? In Miss Greer's book, she speaks of her wish to have a child, as she describes it as a dream of hers, to have a child which she would hand over to some family in Calabria or some Italian village like that. And a lot of of emancipated friends would hand over their babies too to this couple, and the mothers would not even identify themselves to their children. These would be children who wouldn't even know who their mothers were. Now, of course, what would happen with those children is that they would identify with whoever was the nurturing female figure on that scene. The peasant woman who was taking care of them would be the person they would have to identify with. In that way, they would have no relation, more relation with you, Miss Greer, than you have with your own mother, so you would have accomplished what you really want to accomplish then.
This is very insidious. I was brought up by my mother, so that doesn't seem to bear out that assumption. Not only that, but the description of the household that I was dreaming of, so witlessly I might have known it would have been turned into a club to beat me with, was not founded round a peasant couple. The whole point was that we would live there when we could. The reality principle intruded because we had to make enough money to support the household. And there wouldn't just be one nurturing female. I have no desire to perpetuate the situation where there's one nurturing female to be blamed for everything that goes wrong with her offspring. And as for having something to grow by, it seems to me that children gain much more from a variety of female contacts than they do from a single female contact. And in fact, most of the people who talk on this subject in favor of the nuclear family, when you examine it, you find they haven't even got nuclear families themselves. That in some of them, there are four females and three males. In the household described in the beginning of The Prisoner of Sex, there were four nurturing females and three boy children, Norman and his two sons. And if it comes to accuracy, it seems to me, I won't mess about with matters of detail, but radical accuracy is important.
Yes, but...
Hey, Greer, did you come all the way from Australia to learn a cheap shot like that? Well, I mean, it's...
Use a mic, Norman.
It's obviously a cheap...
Because I think it's too serious to do it just so I can defend myself against hecklers in the town bloody hall.
Well, I think it's a cheap shot to say that I was one of the boys, that's all. It's a cheap shot because everybody knows that I'm profoundly boyish. And you could have said one man and lifted your eyebrow and two little boys and made your point with a little more taste, kid. You didn't have to come all the way from Australia to use the kind of crap we used to use in Brooklyn, that's all.
Elizabeth Hardwick.
That's fair.
Norman, I don't think that's fair, what you just said about...
Elizabeth Hardwick is speaking.
Well, I don't have much to say, but when you wrote your piece in Harper's, you made a great deal about being a man who had known very little about what it meant to be a woman and going off with all your little kids and a new one born and your other wife gone. So I don't think you're really being honest when you say that she comes on with that Australian crap. That isn't true, because that was a big part of your experience, may I call it that, of sort of...
You may, yes, you may, Elizabeth.
Well, you called it that. But I was very interested in your experiences about doing the dishes, and so I'm rather unhappy that you're sort of putting down this experience.
No, no, as usual, you don't understand what I'm talking about, Elizabeth. I objected.
Maybe you don't understand
me. I objected to Germaine's characterization of it as four girls and three boys, because whether I am a boy or not, I was trying to function as a housewife for those 6 weeks. I went into it in considerable detail. Everybody who read the section, including Greer, knew goddamn well that that's what it was about, which is I was trying to function as a housewife, and we were looking at the interest and the comedy and the pain and the particular little bit of knowledge that I got out of it. And I did not exaggerate the experience, as you know full well. So I thought to say four girls and three boys was cute, you know, and...
Three daughters living out of the two boys, right? And you also had, if I may quote, a statement saying your mistress was in the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
Now, one is left wondering, what the hell housework was there left to do? What was it that took you 6 weeks to do?
Well, if you'd read even more closely, you would have recognized that it started off where I was doing all the housework. And at about 2 weeks into this venture, I did indeed invite my mistress up and...
Okay, Anatole Broyard will give the final question.
Now, I would like to ask Germaine Greer, as having a peculiar aptitude for this question, to describe, perhaps in the form of a one-act play, what would it be like to be a woman and to have the initiation and consummation of a sexual contact, so that now we can get down to the particulars of the evening. What would it be like after liberation, ideally?
Why do you ask this question?
Because I don't find it anywhere in the literature. I don't.
Why do you expect to find it anywhere in the literature? Norman describes a state of affairs that exists, namely where he is at. You ask me to describe a state of affairs that doesn't exist. It's a perfectly unreasonable demand. What makes you suppose that liberation has happened?
Well, I tried to make my question non-polemical. I'd like to say that I'm...
Oh, you did.
Well, all right, perhaps I didn't succeed. I really don't know what women are asking for. Now, suppose I wanted to give it to them.
Listen, you may as well relax, because whatever it is they're asking for, honey, it's not for you.
No.
Norman, you want to give the closing?
Yeah. All right. Listen. Thank you all for an incredible evening. I'd also like to thank the four women who contributed 9/10 to the discussion.
You agree. You really agree.